Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm so glad that you are here this morning with us.
Glad you're here.
Yes.
Okay, what a beautiful day nowadays. Yeah. Has spring already come to us? Nobody knows yet.
Yeah. 27.
Yeah, I'm so glad to see all the faces that I terribly missed. Can you hear me? My mic is not working.
Not working good.
Not working good. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. I welcome you again in the name of Jesus, our Savior, the Messiah. And it is time for announcement. I will give you the bullet points of our announcement. You can download it, download our bulletin on our church Facebook page. Sunday in-person worship service at 10:30 only with a live stream. I felt so sorry to hear that somebody came to us at 9 a.m. last Sunday to attend our worship service, but yeah, we combined two different services into one worship service from last Sunday. Let us observe a holy season of Lent by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word. So, in our Christian tradition, this season is very holy and sacred. So we should be intentional to come closer and closer to our Savior during the season of Lent. And Lent boxes are available in the front and back side of the sanctuary. Here we go. And just pick up when you enter and exit the sanctuary. Girl Scout cookies ends today, this Sunday, right? So we've got 20...
We got 32.
32, so we didn't beat last year's record, right? 33.
I'm sure there was something.
Okay.
Almost.
Okay. Just a question. So, what are we going to do with these cookies?
We're going to partner with a local Girl Scout group.
Okay.
They take them to the National Guard unit and they ship them for us.
Okay. They'll ship the cookie boxes to... Okay, troops. Farmers to Families program. We did a great time last Wednesday. I really appreciate Steve Souther's leadership for this project. Thank you, Steve.
Can I thank the people that really helped out for that this week? Of course, Pastor John, Esther, Tony Morris, Allison Brandon, and Leland Suggs, Betsy and Ronnie Smith, and my wife Kelly, and my son Landon. And we really handed out a lot of food to help people in the community, and hopefully we'll have several more opportunities to give them out.
Yes.
And I just really want to thank everybody for partnering with the community neighbor, and for getting the food out and getting people in the community. And thanks again to everybody that helped.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everyone who was involved in this wonderful ministry to our local community. And we are scheduled to do this next Wednesday again, March 3rd.
I made an adjustment for that.
Okay.
And I'm going to put out more information than I thought I would have something earlier. The next one is the 17th.
17th. Now, okay. March 17th.
Right.
Okay. Okay, thank you. We have small groups. Of course, a Sunday school class at 9:30 in the JMMC led by Ron Smith. How did it go this morning?
At 10 this morning.
Okay. Okay. And the children's Sunday school, how did it go?
Wonderful.
Yes. Yeah. Preston and Jennifer, what's your name? Jennifer. I really appreciate all the volunteers and amazing teachers for our small groups. And youth, Sundays and Thursdays at 5:30 in our youth room, right? How did it go? Wonderful. Yeah. April has been doing a great job to lead our youth. And young adults at 5 today at the Shipley's.
Over here.
Over yonder, right? Now, on the second floor, and there is a young adult's room. Yeah, you should visit there one time. And there is a coffee bar, right? That is amazing. Yeah, church office hours, as you know. Pastor's office hour. Yeah, our church office hours and pastor's office hours will be added as time goes on. Probably sometime in March. Any announcements you would like to add? And praises? Yes.
We need to announce about the new dismissal.
Yeah. When I dismiss the congregation after the worship service, just stay in your seat, okay? And the brethren will come to the front and he will dismiss the pew by pew, okay? Stay there, okay? And then if you want to talk with your neighbors, go outside in the parking lot and enjoy the sunlight and talk, okay? Yeah, I'm so glad to have more people in our worship service at one service. Thank you. It is time for passing the peace. God's peace be with you. Now look at each other and wave at each other. Yes. Okay, would you rise as we declare our vision statement? It is very, very important. Let's go. Our First United Methodist Church is Jesus-centered, grace-filled, and committed to transforming lives through Christ. Amen. Hear of God's promise.
Promise rests on grace.
God gives life to the dead.
The promise rests on grace.
God calls into being things that did not exist.
The promise rests on grace.
God came to us through Jesus. Jesus died and rose again to save us.
God's grace comes to us through our faith.
Amen. Let us sing together.
Follow Jesus.
Amen. We want to see God, right? Amen. Let us affirm our belief. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. It's time for offertory and individual prayer time. For in-person worshipers, you can drop off your offerings in the place where you enter and exit the sanctuary. For online worshipers, please remember to mail in your offerings to the church post office box. I believe this time is very sacred for you to kneel down before God and think about your daily lives. We have different settings from the sanctuary. It is very unique and special time for you to come to the altar and kneel down on the rail before God. So please maximize this opportunity for your soul. Along with our monetary offering, we also ourselves to God. Bring your anxiety, fear, concern, hope, and desire to the altar and listen to God's voice for you. Surrender, trust me, and the love. Love you. Let us pause in silence. Thank you. remember Ed and Don Moore in your prayers. And please remember Janet Pice in your prayers as well. Please remember Faye Riddle in your prayer and Vivian Soyster in your prayers as well. And Mary Smith, Mark Smith in your prayers, please. And there are many people who are sick and fighting against cancer. And we are looking forward to seeing all of them at the church together as we worship our God. And I will give you a moment in my pastoral prayer. And there will be a moment for you to lift the names up to God. And please remember that you're going to have a moment to mention the names in our prayer. And just mention the names only, okay? Would you bow with me? Our Heavenly Father, you are so gracious, merciful, and mighty, good. We praise you for who you are and what you have for us, God. This morning we come before you, giving thanks, glories, and honors to you alone. Father, there's no one like you who deserves our praises and our worship. Father, we cannot understand how deep, how broad, how mysterious it is for Jesus to die for us, to save us. Father, we don't deserve that sacrificial love, that amazing, incredible love. You always love us. You are always there to support us. Guide our hearts to your purpose, God. You are always there to help us to grow and be strengthened and encouraged. And then you are also calling us to achieve your will, to transform this broken world, God. It's been such a wonderful journey of faith with you, God, to get to know and be guided by the Holy Spirit and just be fulfilling in achieving your will through our lives, God, through our church, God. That we are so grateful for what you have done for us, God. In this season of pandemic, and as we are going through the season of Lent as well, God, I'm asking for your special spiritual touch upon our hearts, upon our body, and upon our families and church and our local community, God. Help us to feel and experience your unfailing, amazing love. And help us to be intentional to get to know you better and more and spend more time with you every day, every moment, God. Father, we are praying for this nation. Save us from violence, discord and confusion. Father, I'm asking you to grant to the President of the United States and Governor of Alabama and to all in authority wisdom and strength to know and to do your will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve these people in your fear. Father, make us instruments of your peace, God. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. where there is sadness, joy. Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life, God. God, Father, thank you for giving us this beautiful, wonderful church families, God. I'm asking for your special protection and guidance for each one of our church families, God. As we gather together to worship you as a church, God, it is our joy and privilege to be here at your house, God. And help us, the online worshipers, to worship you with their hearts and soul and strength as well, God. And help us to be the resources and instrument of hope and encouragement in times of uncertainty, God. I pray for the sick and those who are fighting against sickness, God. God, remember Dot and Ed Moore, Jenny Price, Marcy and Mark Smith, Larry Lindsay, Alan Wall, Faye Riddle, Vivian Soyster, Paula Malcolm, Jennifer Martin, Glenda Gregory, Jack Posey, Mary Smith, Larry Busby, Jackie Campbell. God, it is time for us to mention the names that we are asking you to intervene. Father, in your mercy, hear our prayers. I'm also praying for our youth and children, for the future of this church and your kingdom, God. Our young adults and youth and children, God, inspire their hearts to seek after your will, God. Please help them to enjoy the relationship with you and be guided by the word of God. And bless those who are leading our small groups. Ronnie Smith, Dresden, Jennifer, and our youth director, April, and the Shipley's God. Give them wisdom, strength, and guidance as they are faithful to lead your flock, God. Father, we are here to honor you, to worship you. Father, give us grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed. Give us courage to change the things which should be changed. And give us the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Father, we honor you, we worship you, we glorify your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us look at each other and say, God bless you and love you. Yes. Today's sermon's title is Walking Away, Nobody. really wants to go. That is the way we are called to go. And would you rise as we read this scripture together? Here's Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Let me go first. We gotta read this responsibly, okay? He then began to teach them, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns.
You need all the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and say, whoever wants to be my disciples must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me.
For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it.
What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit their soul?
Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul?
If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There is a psychological term, a confirmation bias. What's that? A confirmation bias, which means that people have a tendency to seek information that confirms their existing beliefs. Okay? I believe everyone has this. For example, imagine that a person holds a belief that left-handed are more creative than the right-handed. And whenever this person encounters a person that is both left-handed and creative, they place greater importance on this evidence to support what they already believe. Okay? This individual might even seek proof that further backs up this belief while discounting examples that don't support this idea. Unfortunately, this type of bias can prevent us from looking at situations objectively. It can also influence the decisions we make and lead us to poor, faulty choices. For example, during an election season, people tend to seek positive information that paints their favorite candidate in a good, positive light. They will also look for information that casts the opposing candidate in a negative light. They don't want to listen to different opinions about their favorite candidate. In today's passage, we encounter one person who has a confirmation bias. His name is Peter. In the previous chapters of the book of Mark, Jesus calls the disciples to follow him, drives out evil spirits, calms the storms, and heals the sick, and preaches on the kingdom of God, feeds the 5,000 people one time, and then later on again, 4,000 people. Peter has witnessed Jesus performing all these wonders. To Peter, Jesus should be the long-promised God-anointed Messiah who would come and give Israel freedom from the oppression of the Roman Empire. His confirmation bias impacts how he interprets Jesus' ministry and reinforces his existing beliefs about Jesus. All of a sudden in today's passage, contrary to Peter's hope and expectation about Jesus says he would undergo suffering, be rejected by religious leaders, and even be killed. This impetuous Peter speaks for us all in taking hold of Jesus, rebuking, scolding Jesus, and correcting him according to verse 32. Surely Peter was thinking, Jesus, are you out of your mind? Everyone believes that Messiah should be anything but a powerful, triumphant, and political and military figure. Don't you know that? You are talking about your suffering, your rejection, and even death? You are wrong, Jesus, at this point. You should be the Messiah. We are expecting you to be. Peter was rebuking this way. Jesus turns and rebukes Peter and then shocks the disciples more deeply by telling them his way of the cross may be their future too. All who would follow Jesus must deny themselves and take up their cross and then follow me, he said. His unexpected and even offense talk continues as he declares, to save your life, you must lose it. What? You may lose your life for the sake of Jesus? In this Jesus, is this Jesus the Jesus you are looking for? Seriously? We only believe in Jesus Christ as our Messiah. To be successful, to be encouraged, to find our rest, right? But Jesus is talking about a very embarrassing message. His message tackles our confirmation bias to him. Sometimes churches put a sign on their lawn in an attempt to attract more people like this. Friendliest church in town. Bingo. Our church. Anxiety. Loneliness. Come to our church and we'll fix them. We have a wonderful, welcoming, loving church family. However, imagine how many people this church would attract if we put a sign up front saying, looking for more pain, more suffering, even death, for the sake of Jesus. You've come to the right place. Join us in our journey of cross with Jesus. How many people our church would attract? It is only natural for us to want to be prosperous, capable, successful, and in control. Therefore, it is only natural for us to misconstrue Jesus as a means of getting what we want, as a path of being the sort of people we would like to be. But this Sunday's gospel shows Jesus leading us down a very different path. Jesus surprises us by the teaching that we are walking a way that nobody wants to go. Jesus speaks to us that we are walking not toward glory and power, but toward rejection, suffering, and death. Let's go back to what Jesus says to the disciples in verses 34 and 35. Read this with me together. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. To follow Jesus, there are two steps. First one is deny yourself and take up your cross. What does this mean? What does that mean exactly? Let me explain this in light of power and powerlessness. We fear people with power. They can control us, and they can force us to do what we don't want to do. We look up to people with power. They have what we don't have. They can go to where we cannot go. We envy people with power. So we long for getting more power. Take a look around the world. The power hungry people are searching frantically for power. They slander, segregate, and manipulate people, and even kill them. You might say, oh, I don't have that kind of power. Oh, I don't want that kind of power. Or, I'm not interested in having power. But when you look within us, with the eyes of God, it is not hard to see the all-pervading lust for power. Aren't we constantly concerned with whether we are noticed or not, appreciated or not, rewarded or not? Aren't we? Aren't we always asking ourselves whether we are better or worse, stronger or weaker, faster or slower than the one who stands beside us? Haven't we experienced our fellow human beings as rivals in the race for success, influence, and popularity? And aren't we so insecure about who we are that we will grab any form of power that gives us a control over who we are, what we do, and where we go? Aren't we? Nobody can be free from the temptation of power. Even when we pray to God, we tend to perceive our God as the almighty and powerful God. In our thoughts, God should be mighty to save us and provide everything we need. That's why we believe in God. Many Christians ask God for more health, more success, more peace, more strength, and more abundance. I believe God can do all these things if God wills. I believe our God is mighty and powerful God. However, you may be very surprised if you know the power symbols of our God. Let me show you. This is the power symbol of our God that we believe in. Not eagle, not elephant or eagle. This is the power symbol of our Almighty God. How is it different from your confirmation bias to God? It is a baby in a manger. It is a miracle man died on the cross. God chose to be powerless. God chose to be powerless. God chose to enter into human history in complete weakness. God became human in no way different from other human beings to do what? To unmask the illusion of power. To unmask the illusion of power. At the cross, people jeer at him, laugh at him, spit in his face, and shout, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Come, he is the King of Israel, let him come down from the cross, and thou wilt believe in him." He hangs there, his flesh torn apart, his heart broken. When you believe in Jesus, what kind of Jesus do you look at? What kind of Jesus do you look at? Jesus, the powerless child of God, is blessed in powerlessness. In the Beatitude, that is the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus offers us self-portrait. Look at this. Blessed are the poor. He said, Jesus was poor, not in control, but marginal in society. He was told, what good can come from Nazareth? He said, blessed are the gentle. Jesus did not break the bruised reed. He always cares for the little ones. He never forsakes the little, powerless ones. He said, blessed are those who mourn. Jesus did not hide his grief, but let his tears flow when his friend died. And when he foresaw the disruption of Israel, he said, Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for justice. Jesus didn't hesitate to criticize injustice in a society and to defend the hungry and the dying and the lepers. Jesus said, blessed are the merciful. Jesus didn't always call for revenge, but healed always and everywhere. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in heart. Jesus remains focused only on what is necessary and does not allow his attention to be divided by many distractions. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers. Jesus did not stress differences, but reconciled people as brothers and sisters in one family. Jesus said, blessed are those who are persecuted. Jesus did not expect success or popularity, but he knew that rejections and abandonment would make him suffer. It is a portrait of the powerless God that we believe in. It is also the portrait we glimpse wherever we see the sick, the prisoners, the refugees, the lonely, the victims of abuse, the dying, and the marginalized and isolated in our society. It is through their powerlessness that we are called to become brothers and sisters. It is through their powerlessness that we are called to deepen our friendship and love for them. It is through their powerlessness that we are challenged to lay down our weapons, offer forgiveness, and make peace. However, look at our world, which is ruled by diabolic powers that divide and destroy. How should we live in this world as witness to a powerless God and build a kingdom of love and peace? This is a very crucial and challenging question to all of us. To answer this question properly, we have to understand the meaning of powerlessness that I'm speaking about. Does powerless mean that we are doomed to be doormat for our power-hungry society? No way. Does it mean that it is good to be passive and submissive, always allowing the powers of darkness to dominate our lives? No way. Does it mean that economic weakness and physical, emotional weakness have now become virtues all of a sudden? No way. Does it mean that people who are poorly prepared for their tests can now brag about their poverty as a blessing that calls for gratitude? No way. It is not what powerlessness means. If a theology of weakness becomes a theology for weaklings, then such a theology is an uncomfortable excuse for our incompetence, submissiveness, low self-esteem, self-denigration, and defeat in all fields. However, a theology of weakness challenges us to look at our weakness as a total and unconditional dependence of God. That opens us to be true channels of the divine power. Did you hear me? Through the powerless Jesus, God wants us to be empowered. God wants to empower us, give us the power that Jesus had, and send us out to cast out the demons, to heal the sick, to reconcile the estranged, to create community of faith, and to build the kingdom of God. We are comforted, have our fill, experience mercy. We are recognized as God's children and see God through this powerless Jesus. This power, that's real power, that's the power coming from the above. And then, how do we keep moving from dividing power to uniting power, from destructive power to healing power? from paralyzing power to enabling power. Let me suggest three things. First, believe that we are given the divine power from God. And we are called to be the divine channel of power transforming this broken world. Everyone has a season of life, different seasons of life. And there is a time for all of us to feel powerless, frustrated, and depressed. God knows your agonies and sufferings and pains. If you are in that season of life, look at this powerless Jesus and meditate on him deeply. God wants us to be powerless before him so that he wants us to be filled with God's power. God wants you to be powerless before him so that you can be filled with his heavenly power, transforming power. How is it possible? It is through denying yourself. Denying yourself! In other words, it is possible through total dependence upon him, through total surrender to him. God wants us to live fully in the present, depending on God each moment, every day, and train your mind to seek God's help continually, even when you feel competent to handle something by yourself. Remember this. And the second discipline is to focus always on the poor and the marginalized. This is the way you can experience your power in godly ways without being corrupt. If you think that there are some things you have more than other people, this means you are called to serve other people with your power and send out your blessings to those in need. We need to ask ourselves, where are the men and women and children who are waiting for us to reach out to them? We have to ask this question as often as possible. Even though you feel powerless, there should be always someone around you who you can help. If you decide to live your life that way, trust that God will give you what you need. Last Wednesday, it was a God moment for me to be willing and to be ready to be available to our local community. I felt the purpose of this church that exists for. In this pandemic, we are concerned about our health, our security, and we are just frustrated because everything is not in our control. But we became willing and ready and reluctant to be the resource of help and encouragement as a church. I was so excited, and I'm really excited to see our church families reaching out to our local community, just welcoming and just becoming the hands and feet of Jesus, representing the love and grace of our Savior to our local community. You know what? I really wanted for a long time to reach out to our local neighbors around our church. I drove our church van and just put 15 boxes, the food boxes, into a van and just drove around our neighbors. And I knocked the doors and just, probably I looked like a sage person to knock the door. But that's why I intentionally just drove our church van. United Methodist Church, one just person, "Oh, Methodist, Methodist!" And one lady, after knocking the door, and I introduced myself, "I'm the pastor of this Methodist church, and I'm a Baptist!" No, I didn't mean that. Okay, we have a food box for you, available for you. No, thank you. And one lady just really, really appreciated my visiting. And one guy just introduced me to his neighbor who are in need. So I just delivered that box to the lady, and she really, really appreciated it. It was a God moment for me to get to know our neighbors around the church. And I've been thinking that I have to do this more often. And John Wesley said that ministering to the poor is only possible by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It is beyond our capacity. You know, with our basic instinct, we are not willing to do this uncomfortable thing. But I saw many of our church families willing and ready to do this. So I am so honored and privileged to be part of this wonderful church. The third discipline is the hardest one. It is the discipline to be surprised by joy, not by suffering. There is always suffering ahead of us. But don't be surprised by pain. Be surprised by joy. Be surprised by the little flower that shows its beauty in the midst of barren desert. Whenever I feel weary and anxious about my life, God reminds me of how beautiful the creation of God is. God reminds me of how He has blessed my life. Count your blessings you've gotten. God, choose to be surprised by joy. Choose to give them to God in every situation. Be surprised by joy, not by suffering, okay? Amen?
Amen?
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called to deny ourselves, take up our cross to follow Jesus. This is the way that nobody wants to go through. But this is the path of Jesus, who chose to be powerless to show the world the true meaning of power, the transforming power of love to heal, renew, and revive this broken world. Don't forget this. You are given the power from God. Walk through this valley of darkness, performing the miracles of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen? God's power becomes ours. And God's power goes out from us wherever we go and to whomever we meet. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Would you rise and sing together? As we sing together, as we dismiss, ask God to set us on fire of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We need that power from the above.
Shine on me, shine.
will be the light of Jesus upon this broken world. God, consecrate us. Purify our hearts. Fill our hearts with your Spirit. And use us to transform this broken world. Shine your glory through us into this world, God. God, thank you for showing us the true meaning of power. God, to follow you, deny ourselves, and take up our cross, God. Help us to be able to do that, God. As we dismiss, may the peace of God the Father, the grace of Jesus the Son, the communion and the guidance of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.